came to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." And all were speaking well of him and wondering at the glorious words which were falling from his lips. And they were saying, "Is this not Joseph's son?" And he said to them, "No doubt you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal thyself.' Wherever you heard it was done in Capernaum, do here in your hometown." And he said, "Truly I say to you, no prophet is welcome in his hometown. But I say to you a truth, there were many widows in Israel in the day of Elijah, and the sky was shut up for 3 years and 6 months, for the great famine came over the land. And Elijah was sent to none of them, but only Zephora in the land of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow there. And there were many lepers in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was cleansed, but only Naaman the Syrian. And all the people in the synagogue were filled with rage as they heard these things. And they got up and they drove him out of the city and led him to the brow of the hill on which the city had been built in order to throw him down the cliff. But passing through their midst, he went his way." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I want you all to use your imaginations a little bit this morning. I want you to imagine that you lived in the 1700s. We wouldn't have the big, beautiful buildings. We wouldn't have any air conditioning. We probably wouldn't have Jesus rolls up the scroll, then he hands it back to the attendant and he says, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." And the worshipers are amazed. And they seem to be saying to one another, "See, I knew it. I knew it all along. I knew it. I knew he was the one. I knew he was something special." And they were impressed. And they were so impressed, and they were buzzing so much that they almost missed what he said next. "A prophet is not without honor, except in his hometown." Wait, what did he just say? Elijah and Elisha? They weren't able to perform any miracles among the Israelites. They ministered to foreigners in their distress. Now the mood has shifted. These Jews, these God's chosen people, they have lived in the privilege of knowing that they are special, that the Messiah was going to come to them, that he was going to bring about prosperity to them, that he was going to set them up with David's kingdom. And now Jesus is telling them, "I am the Messiah. I am the anointed one. And I'm not coming for you. I'm coming for the foreigners, for the ones among you that you would reject." And now they have a decision to make. They can give up their wrongful beliefs, their sense of privilege as God's chosen people. They could lose their comfort of being able to remain exclusive. If they lose their comfort, they can follow Jesus. If they accept Jesus' teaching, they will have to be open. They'll have to be open to the realization that Jesus and the prophets tried to teach through the ages. God didn't choose them to be exclusive. God didn't choose them to be set up on a shelf like a trophy that no one is allowed to touch. God chose them to go. He chose them to go into the entire world. He chose them to go to the foreigner. He chose them to go to the outcast. He chose them to go to the brokenhearted. He chose them to go and spread God's love, God's mercy, God's forgiveness, God's grace to the Gentiles, to those that they found most repulsive. God chose them for that purpose. And at the end of the gospel story, unlike the judge in the Mark Marshall story, they were not so persuaded by the Messiah's words. In fact, they chose to reject not only the message, but the messenger himself. They drag him to the edge of the city, and they go to throw him over the cliff to kill him. This was a common way of stoning someone to death in Jesus' time. And Jesus manages to slip away. But that leaves us wondering, how does this story, how does this relate to us? My message is entitled, "What Have You Got to Lose?" The judge and the police officer in Martha's story, they were appointed most likely because of their standing in their church. The church had a lot of political power in that time, and the church would often appoint people to be judges, to be officers, to keep the peace. They could have lost their position. What did they have to lose? They could have lost everything. For the established church, who had the power and the influence, what did they have to lose if they let these Baptists come in, preaching a message of individual faith, an individual relationship with God? They could lose all of their political power. They could lose all of their religious power. What did they have to lose? For Martha, she could have easily taken a safe path. She didn't have to preach. She didn't have to be a Baptist preacher's wife.
So now take this bread, eat it, and remember